All right, good morning, everyone. Half asleep, are we? Good morning. Let's all stand. That much better. Let's all stand, and we're going to open our service in prayer. Welcome to those of you that are joining us online. It is a privilege to have you with us, and let's bow in prayer. Our God, we thank you for a great morning already. We thank you for our Bible study, and we thank you, Father, for those that were here yesterday for the workshop. And John's lesson just tied in beautifully with what we were learning. And thank you so much for John Caputo and Kim. Thank you that they can be with us today. Thank you, Father, for their ministry. And thank you for John's encouragement today to really inspire us to be about our Father's business. And Father, I pray that you would bless him today as he shares and updates us on their ministry. Pray that you would just continue to knit our hearts together with them. And Lord, help us to be a blessing to the Caputos. Bless those that are still traveling. Bless those that are watching us online. Father, use your word to glorify yourself. We pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Please remain standing. We'll sing a song.
All right, let's take our hymnals. We'll open up to hymn 444. I love you, Lord. Hymn 444.
Good morning. Welcome to Bible Baptist Church. I don't see any first-time visitors here today. Those of you that are online, if it's your first service joining us, welcome. Just a couple quick announcements. Mainly, we are having our quarterly business meeting this Wednesday, and it should be just routine going over the finances and such, but we'd hope you can make it. And we are doing it online, so those of you that would get the link for the prayer meeting, especially if you're a member, we encourage you to tune in if you're not planning on being with us live here on Wednesday. And I want to praise the Lord for yesterday. We had the Share Your Faith workshop. We had 18 people come out. It was just a great blessing. And it's as if John was here. And what John challenged us with this morning in our Bible study couldn't have been more perfectly dovetailed. And John took it the next level. I mean, that was just beautiful this morning. Thank you, brother, for that. Any testimonies of those that were here yesterday that want to just share a testimony? Just a minute or two, brief testimony. Anybody? Basically, I guess it's just Jim, Serena, or Mary. Do either of you want to say anything? Oh, Jonathan? No, Josh, that's right. I know you're... Anybody want to say anything about it? Go ahead, Jim. We need, amen, amen. I was, you know, when your expectations are low, I was thankful for every single person that came, and it was a blessing. It was a long day, wasn't it?
It was, yeah.
Yeah, but it was. Praise the Lord, though. Thank you. Amen. It was good. Amen. Amen. All right. Oh, Serena, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Awesome.
Like meet them at their
level. Amen. Serena, yes, praise the Lord. Serena's just sharing what John tied in this morning, and I realize that the people online have no idea what's being said out there. But we had a great time, and we're real blessing. In fact, when we went out to 69th Street after, we did have one lady profess faith in Christ, and we were only there for an hour, had a lot of opportunities to hand out tracts, and several gospel presentations were given, so we're grateful for that. All right, we are, as you know, we don't hand the offering plate out, so we just encourage you to come up here and give, or if you don't want to give, and you normally would do it in the back, if you could just wait till after the service, because the offering plate that's in the back is going to be for the Caputo's love offering, so just so you keep that in mind, that plate in the back will be for the Caputo's. The plates up here are for our offering, so we'll pray. Josh will play an offertory, and then if you're not comfortable with coming up in front of everyone, and I totally get it, I hate people looking at me. But anyway, then you can just do it after we're done, okay? After the service, you can just come up and put it in. But the front offering is for our offering. Let's bow in prayer right now. Father, thank you for meeting the needs of Bible Baptist Church for the last 29 years. Father, thank you that we've never gone into debt, never just, you've just met every need that we've had, and we are grateful. And we pray that you'd continue to supply your need as we wait on you. And Father, I ask your blessing upon our offering today. And then, Lord, as people will give to John and Kim in the plate in the back on the way out, we just pray that you would bless that as well. Pray you give us a great time in your word today and help us to magnify the Savior together. Remind us, Father, that this is a worship service. And even our giving of our finances, our money to you, is part of our worship. So please receive this unto yourself. We pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Oh, that's right. Are we doing that? Sorry, Josh.
Josh's offertory, please announce offertory number. And then say we will be singing it next week. Okay, I'm going to announce the number that Josh is playing. And then we're going to be singing it next week, okay? 638. Hymn 638. He's going to play it. And this is a new song for us, right? For many of us. So listen, watch, look at the book. Look at your Rejoice hymnal, 638. And then next week we will be singing that. Thank you, Josh.
We've heard that many times. It's nice to see the words to it, though. All right, let's turn to hymn 615, On Jordan's Stormy Banks, hymn 615.
Stand and cast a wishful eye to Canaan's fair and happy land, where my possessions lie. I am bound for the promised land. I am bound for the promised land. Oh, who will come and go? I am bound for the promised land. All o'er these wide extended plains shine one eternal day. There God the Son forever reigns and scatters night away. I am bound for the promised land. Happy place and be forever blessed. When shall I see my Father's face and His bosom rest? I am bound for the promised land. I am bound for the promised land. Oh, who will come in?
All right, I want to remind you, John will probably talk about his display in the back, but there's an offering plate there, and for today, this morning, that's going to be for the Caputos. That's a love offering for them. Please keep that in mind when you leave. It is our privilege today to have Missionary John and Kim Caputo with us. They have a camp. They've been a part of campus ministry. Did you say we've been supporting you for 26 years? 26 years we've been supporting them. That's a big blessing. And that means you were one of our first missionaries then. You know, that is awesome. Of course, the Caputos and I go way back. But what a blessing. They began, I guess, on Westchester University campus. And then did you go from there to Millersville? And how long have you been at Millersville?
We've been there
16 years.
But we were at Westchester. Now we have a convert. I'll share it.
Yeah. Okay, praise the Lord. Awesome. So today John is going to share with us update on the ministry, and then he's going to preach the word. If you weren't here this morning, we should rewind it, but we didn't record it, unfortunately. But it was just phenomenal. And John is a very precious friend, and John and Kim. And what a precious couple. God has blessed them. And so we're just going to turn the rest of the service over to him. I told him he needs to wrap it up by 2 o'clock. Is that all right with you all?
Oh, I like that. You won't like it. What time do we have, Phil, actually? When is the official time that when people start getting antsy and it's time to wrap it? When is it now?
10 of.
Yeah, but you'll like me more if it's sooner, right?
Yeah, probably.
All right. Well, hey, listen, it's a blessing times 10 for us to come back and to see the faithful pastor and his wife that you've had here since the very, very beginning. And it's part of the joy of witnessing for Christ to see. You never know who the Lord's going to do something unusual with. And it doesn't really matter because there's other couples that are pleasing the Lord, just doing the right thing with themselves and their children. But that's the joy of it. And I hope that some that were here for Sunday school and others that will get a smidgen of missions and just what this book can still do, on the secular college campus amongst all the crazies that don't know what bathroom they should use, boys or girls room today. How do I feel about my sexual orientation? I think they're up to 15 different gender identities now on campus. Pretty scary. But, you know, people get tired of ever moving, no absolutes, no guarantees. Like, you mean there are promises and guarantees? Are you kidding me? Yeah, so this is something that still works and has power on campus. As far as what we do, the secular college campus is an often missed opportunity. It's a very fertile mission field. 15 million students from all different countries even. 90% of our Christian kids are on a secular college campus. So guess what? It's a dangerous place. It's difficult. So we're there to not only evangelize and disciple, but also, can I say, salvage those Christians that are being pressured every single day. And so it's a good thing for them to have something where they can rally. And we've rescued a few who were drifting away. Someone is drifting, you know, the lifeline salvation, but also for walking with God. And some of those people are now in full-time ministry. So it's like, you know, the Lord will use it. So you're going to see some testimonies in a little bit. But I want you to understand a few things. Christians and higher education have always been together. So anyone who thinks, oh, Bible Christianity, you know, it's not for the educated. Can I tell you something? 104 of the first 119 universities were built by Christians. And guess what their purpose was? To learn to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Harvard University started out as Harvard Divinity School. It existed for over 100 years before they ever had a single professor who was not a Christian. Can you believe that? I meant a minister. So think about it. Harvard Divinity School started that way. What caused them to vacillate? Sports, football, other... You guys are similar to us. And before you know it, things kind of got secularized, but sports was one of the ways that that happened. 500,000 roughly international students from over 200 countries come to the U.S. because they think they're going to get a better education. It's a great opportunity. They're away from oppressive cultures and family structures where they can hear the gospel. Where? The secular campus. So some of you can maybe consider influencing your children to think if they're heading into some kind of ministry. You take your Bible, you get a Bible map in the back, and you follow what the Apostle Paul on his four different missionary journeys did, and they're all seaport cities, right? Well, why did he pick them? A lot of coming and going. That's exactly what the campus is like, right? So it's a strategic place where you can get the gospel out. And we've had people from Japan and China and all sorts of kind of Liberia just got saved last year or last semester. And they don't have a big international, populace there at Millersville, where we're at now. But a lot of good gets done. So can you influence your children, grandchildren? Can you consider if we lose Jerusalem, remember Judea, Samaria, right? If you lose Jerusalem, America is Jerusalem, right? We're the main propagator of the gospel. We got the money. We kind of put a lot out. We're losing Jerusalem. We need to help ourselves and help the next generation. Give them something to shoot for than the indoctrination and all the crazy stuff that they're being pushed, that's being pushed on. We need to give them an alternative, not religion, not quote Christianity, but can I say biblical Christianity? That's the difference. Okay, we're going to go to our video. And if you have any questions afterwards at the back, feel free to ask away. And then I'll bring the word to you after that's over.
My wife Kim and myself have enjoyed and been blessed as we've served for the last 22 years on the secular college campus here in the United States, primarily in Pennsylvania. The secular college campus is a very fertile mission field in our country that is widely neglected by our fundamental churches. Our mission is to bring the gospel and strong biblical discipleship to the future leaders and next generation on our secular college campuses. Most of our Christian college-age kids are on the secular campus, and research and experience has shown that most, 67% on average, of Christian kids will not attend a fundamental church, or any church for that matter, after 4 to 6 years of what I'll call secular indoctrination. College Bible Fellowship is a local church-based approach to ministry rather than a parachurch approach. Our burden is building the local church by reaching the local campus. The emphasis is the Great Commission to go to baptize, but also to teach all things. So the focus is very strongly on evangelism, but also on discipleship. Some specific areas that we concentrate on in ministry would be large group Bible study, which meets once a week with an emphasis on careful study of the Word of God. Typical activities that take place is a time of praise and prayer, student salvation testimonies every week, student devotional challenge, occasional special speakers. Other ministries include one-on-one personal evangelism studies and personal mentoring and discipleship. And it's a chance for students to get their individual spiritual needs met and to grow in the biblical model. Every year in September, we do an annual cookout outreach where we attract upwards of 500 students. It's a huge evangelistic outreach that combines our churches that send volunteers along with our students, and a lot of free food, allows for religious surveys and gospel testimonies to usually several hundred students during that effort. And of course, we have a local church worship emphasis as well on Sundays, and introducing recently saved and other seeking students to a biblical New Testament church is another critical, important aspect of College Bible Fellowship. Most students have never been to a biblically sound church. Their experience will help them find the right kind of church after they graduate. And we now have many students who are serving the Lord in various capacities throughout the country, and some even outside of the United States. College Bible Fellowship is another ministry, provides alternatives to the party scene and giving them a chance to have some God-honoring fellowship. And so that's another important aspect. We have an athletes outreach. We conduct devotionals with various sports teams.
Pastor John and Kim alone have led me to Christ and have got me away from going down the wrong path by bringing up the gospel, the good news, scriptures. Prayer is another thing that's been very important. Things like that have helped me along the way. And just meeting weekly with Pastor John on Tuesday night along with our one-on-ones is keeping me focused.
My family's been going through a hard time, and I kind of realized how severe it was when I went home for Christmas break, and my mom was like crying all the time, and my sister was acting out, and then so happened I found God at that time and passed the word on to them. And luckily enough, there was a church right down the street, 15 minutes from the street, and had a connection with you, Pastor John. And the first time they went, they loved it, and they tried other churches and they weren't feeling it at first, but then when they found that one that you had set us up with, they loved it. And now my mom's actually having a better relationship with my dad and dealing with the situation a lot better, and my sister's a lot happier. In terms of me, I always had trouble since I went to college making friends and doing the correct things and having confidence in myself. And school-wise, I was falling off a little bit this year. And ever since I started going to the Bible study and worshiping God, my grades have gotten better, and I have a lot more friends now, and I am in my own individual with God instead of, you know, trying to copy someone else or live someone else's life.
I was in a rough living situation just with the people I was around, and that's sort of why I stuck to myself, because I didn't want to associate with all those people. And, you know, I dealt with a lot of problems, like both my parents passing away, and I just struggled with that, and I thought I could do it all on my own, but as things got really tough, I realized that everything was bigger than me, and I needed help from an outside source. And instead of you having the Bible study, and I was like, you know what, I need to go check this thing out. And then when I did, I fell in love that first day, so I'm really glad that I did that.
Without CBF, I would not have been saved. It has helped me get through all the craziness I've had come up between the past year of just being at Millersville and having the community to rely on and have others pray for me and not feel alone as a Christian on such a large campus has helped immensely.
When I meet on for my one-on-ones with Pastor John, we open up with a prayer. I go over the things that I need prayer about, or like that we know other people need help with, and we touch on other people's needs before we touch our own. And sitting with him, we usually go over good biblical concepts, and within a matter of days, most of the time, what I learned, I'm able to use to help someone else out who's struggling at some point in their lives.
And with this organization, I was able to receive the gift, start a new life, a Christian living life, following God, and just helping others, leading them to receiving the gift, and just leading this organization, being the president for College Bible Fellowship. Didn't think I'd honestly be here today if I wouldn't have come to a Tuesday night Bible study, and getting to know Pastor John and Kim as well. They alone have led me to Christ.
So maybe you'll have some questions later on. We'll be glad to answer those. But I hope that you are much encouraged by what you saw, knowing that the gospel still changes lives, and these students are rescued. They're thankful for that. And that can happen in your community, your local college campus. Anything we could ever do to be helpful towards that end, we would be glad to do that. So, with that said, I hope that inspires you a little further towards outreach ministry, because if kids can get saved on a secular campus, others that are not in that environment, which is so hostile, can also respond. And I do want to say, you know, make sure you start with people you know that are kind of seeing something in you, or they think you're a nice person for some reason, and make your job easier. Simple as that. You don't have to go knocking on doors, and there's nothing wrong and everything right with it, but don't ignore the obvious, right, of just who you already know. And you can go a long way and get a better success rate with that whole thing overall. Okay, I'm going to ask you to take your Bibles to the book of Acts, chapter 27. The book of Acts, chapter 27, after a little intro, we'll have a word of prayer, but for now, I just want to give you a few thoughts as you turn to that book, Acts chapter 27. You find here God sets up an opportunity for us to observe and learn a valuable lesson about living an influential life, an intimate life, a powerful life as a Christian, even in the worst of times. You're going to see just how bad it is during what is being recorded here by Dr. Luke concerning his perilous journey with the Apostle Paul and 274 other souls. And Acts 27 is Paul being transported deported as the Lord's prisoner to Rome. God says, you're going to go and you're going to give a testimony in Rome. And so while he's being transported, God allows a storm of a high, terrifying magnitude, a life-threatening storm where those fishermen, mariners, people that were familiar, just they gave it up and they thought it's over. And you'll see that come out in the scripture. But we'll want to read down at verse 13. So go to Acts 27, verse 13. Follow with me, please, as I read. And when the south wind blew, supposing that they had obtained their purpose, loosing thence, they sailed close to Crete. But not long after, there arose against them a tempestuous wind called Euroclydon. In case you're wondering what that word is, I looked it up. It's a half Greek, half Latin term used by sailors to describe a strong northeasterly wind. Okay? So it sounds more potent, powerful, scary to say Euroclydon. And so God always has the right way of bringing out. So a tempestuous wind against them, verse 15. It was so bad that when the ship was caught and could not bear up into the wind, we let her drive. So there's 276 souls on this boat, and they're just getting started. And they had to let the boat just go whichever way the wind was going to blow it, because otherwise it was going down. And running under a certain island, which is called Clauda, we had much work to come by the boat to simply control anything that was going on, to keep it adrift. Which when they had taken up, they used helps undergirding the ship, and fearing lest they should fall into the quicksands, strake sail, and so were driven. And we being exceedingly tossed with a tempest, the next day they lightened the ship, literally to keep their heads above water. We're throwing stuff out. And the third day, so what's going on? Third day, verse 19, we cast out with our own hands the tackling of the ship. Is it over yet? No. And when neither sun nor stars in many days appeared, and no small tempest lay on us, all hope that we should be saved was then taken away. So now you got seasoned mariners that are just saying, look, this is it. We're going down. We're not going to live. And so that was the start of this whole journey. And in it, you're going to find in just the next little couple of verses a very important statement that Paul makes in the midst of this whole horrific tempest, Euroclydon. Okay? Follow with me. Go down to where we leave off, I guess, verse 21. But after long abstinence, what's that mean? Nobody was eating. Not just Paul, but nobody. Yeah, you think you're going to die. You're ready to go down any moment. You kind of want to be there, I guess. You can't go to sleep. The adrenaline's pumping. The fear is there, right? So, long abstinence. Paul stood forth in the midst of them and said, it's kind of funny, really, when you think about it. Sirs, you should have hearkened unto me and not loosed from Crete, and to have gained this harm and loss. Well, why didn't they listen to him? Because he was a Jewish guy, small likely, not much to look at. We're the fishermen. We'll handle it. We'll get you where you're supposed to go, because we've been paid to do so by Caesar. You're going to Rome. You'll get there. Well, Paul starts out, you should have listened. Not the best idea, but, you know, he did what he did. Now, verse 22, I exhort you to be of good cheer, for there shall be no loss of any man's life among you, but of the ship. The ship's going down, but nobody's going to die. Verse 23, how do you know? For there stood by me this night the angel of God, the term angel, messenger, right, of God, whose I am. Those are the three words I want you to concentrate on. Whose I am. That's the title of the message. Whose I am and whom I serve, saying, fear not, Paul, thou must be brought before Caesar, and lo, God hath given thee all them that sail with thee. What is that? Oh, because of Paul, the rest of them are going to get to live. If it wasn't for Paul being on that boat, they're going to go down. So for God's man to get to God's appointed place, you're all going to make it. Wow. Yeah. One spiritual man, one spiritual woman can bring a lot of favor on a lot of people. You be that person. You be that example to your children, your grandchildren, to neighbors, and so on. It's a blessing to represent God. And verse 25, be of good cheer, for I believe God that it shall be even as it was told. So we see here a secret of Paul's great faith and trust in the Lord no matter what the circumstances were. Whether he was getting beat up, threatened, attacked, stoned, taken up for dead, led over in a basket over a wall and escaping, it didn't really matter. Being in the middle of a storm, Paul was able to see God in it. And how is it that that was possible? I would suggest to you in those three words, whose I am. Paul could go through anything. He could go through the storm. He could be cheerful. He could sense God's presence because he knew, he really knew he belonged to God. And that changed everything. Someone made a statement, Watchman Nee, in a book, The Normal Christian Life. And by the way, what we're living in the U.S. is not the normal Christian life. All right? Not at all. We're not even close. We would be embarrassed by the kind of commitment, worship, whatever. It's tough living in the culture here. I don't know if it's easier or harder. I think it's harder to live where we live because you know your enemy is always after you. Right? You're always on guard. You're always alert. Here it's a subtle frog in the kettle kind of thing, right? And you're just kind of in a drift and a little current, and you're just always there coming at you. Not bad things necessarily, just not godly, but just nice things, good things. Just kind of, you know, it just takes you away slowly. Difficult culture to operate. But Watchman Nee in this his book, he said, I must first have the sense of God's possession of me. Now listen, I have to have the sense of God's possession of me before I can have the sense of his presence with me. Think about that a little bit. If I really know that God possesses me, that I'm his and he is mine, then I can sense his presence. Storm or no storm. He was the only one that was getting a lot of okay. And God says, I can meet up with that guy and let him know the rest are going to live as well. So, I have to know whose I am. Let's pray and we'll go on and develop just a little bit of that. Father, we bow gladly in the name of Jesus, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the one with whom we have to do, the one who is preparing a place for those who have called on the name of Jesus as personal Savior. Thank you for what you will do through your word. You've rehearsed, you've kept this testimony by Dr. Luke in our book, in your book, and that we can read it in our Bibles and be helped 2,000 years later. So thank you for what you'll accomplish, for your honor, for our good. In Jesus' name, amen. So think about it. Hey, this is worthy. I suppose John said, of all the things that should be written about Jesus were written, I suppose even the whole world should not be able to contain, right, all the things that should be written. So, you know, we learned that in this book we have a selective history. What God wants us to know and keep in mind. We can have other books and that's all good, but this is where the authority is, right? The words that I have spoken, the same shall be your judge in the last day, Jesus said. So this is what trumps everything else, right? The other stuff's nice, but it might not be entirely accurate, or the priority of the communication may not be around who it is. What's this book saying? Old, New Testament. Jesus Christ is the King of Kings. Jesus Christ needs to be looked at. Every single book in this Bible, and the word Bible means what? The book. God only wrote one book. Right here. That's it. That's why it's called the Bible. The book. That's what Bible means. Jesus said when he comes back, this is free, comes back, he's wearing a vesture, and on his vesture is written a name. And what's that name? The Word of God. Why would he choose to come back and rule and reign with a vesture and the name the Word of God? Must be of primary importance. Right? We need to kind of, there's lots of other scriptures that bring out that emphasis. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. What? What's this play on Word and God and Jesus? And yeah, it's all to draw attention to Jesus and the living Word, Jesus, and the written Word. Why have not you done all that Moses has written? Right? Coming back. So, all of that to say, we have a 2,000-year-old document preserved that we're supposed to be learning from, and we can learn vicariously, so we don't have to go through the experience of this to gain a lot of the benefits. So, in verse 26, God's testimony continues. Follow with me. Paul says, nobody's going to die. It's all stay on the boat. And I believe, verse 25, all that God has said. Howbeit, however, we must be cast upon a certain island. Okay. God said there's going to be an island. We're out in the middle of the Mediterranean Sea. By the way, if you took your Bible map out in the back of your Bible, if you have one of those, you will see that there's only one island, and one island only, that this boat, ship of 276 men is blown. There's a speck in the middle of the Mediterranean Sea, 60 miles from any other landmass. That's the closest, 60 miles. And the boat just happens to get blown to that exact spot. Look it up. It's known as the Island of Malta today. Wow. Talk about the providence of God. Howbeit, we must be cast on a certain island. The only island. There's nothing else out there. Pretty exciting. I said, where is that island? I'm like, wow, what's the chances? That's God. When he says something, it's going to happen. Get excited. Yeah, I don't like this world. I don't like the way things are going. I don't like the way the president. I don't either, but it's okay. We're under the judgment of God, deservedly so. We're also under the blessing of God, but there's judgment coming to get people's attention. Any kind of people that say, it's the economy, stupid, you know they're off. It isn't. It's God, stupid. But you don't get it. You don't get it. So he's got to bring us down financially. Do you think we can just keep printing money out of thin air? Money grows on trees today. Didn't you know that? I grew up, my parents, well, you know, money doesn't grow on trees. How many used to be told that growing up, right? It does today. Yeah. Need more? Print more. Like there's not going to be, but God's using all of this. So God's working his plan. So, all of that to say, go down to verse 33. You're going to notice how, again, Paul is using all of this. And while the day... Oh, wait. Let's go back up a little bit. I'm skipping here a little bit too much. Where did we leave off? Okay, we left off and we must be cast, verse 26, at a certain island. But when the 14th night... Paul, thanks for the good news. 14 nights have gone by. Right? And we were driven up and down in Adria, another word for the Mediterranean. About midnight, the shipmen deemed that they drew near to some country or some piece of ground, and sounded and found it 20 fathoms. What is a fathom? I looked it up. A fathom is the length, the average length of a man's arm. 31, 34 inches, something like that. So when you multiply it out, approximately 50 feet. And when they had gone a little further, they sounded again and found it 15 fathoms, about 37 feet. Uh-oh, we're in a big boat. We might need to kind of throw the anchor or whatever we got left in here. Verse 29, then fearing lest we should have fallen upon rocks, they cast four anchors out of the stern, I love this, and wished for the day. I sure hope we get some daylight. It's been awfully dark, awfully long. And as the shipmen were about to flee out of the ship, when they had let down the boat into the sea under color, the false idea, as though they would have cast anchors out of the foreship, Paul said to the centurion and to the soldiers, except these abide or stay in the ship, you cannot be saved. Everybody's got to stay in the boat. That's what God said. Now the ship's going down, but nobody, and all of a sudden Paul's like dictating, because look what happens in verse 32. Then the soldiers cut off the ropes of the boat and let her fall off. Wow, that's not normal. Why would you do that? Well, Paul said so. Yeah, but why would you listen to him? Well, look, everything he said so far has happened. And we're going this way because we are not doing well when we don't listen to that guy. Even when he said, sirs, you should have listened and not departed. Right? So God was raising up his man little by little in an authoritative position. And while, verse 33, the day was coming on, Paul besought them all to take meat, saying, this day is the 14th day that you have tarried and continued fasting, having taken nothing. Now, these weren't spiritual men necessarily. They were fasting? Was that a spiritual thing? No, it wasn't. They were so scared out of their wits that they didn't eat. And Paul said, God, look, you need to eat something. It's been 2 weeks. I don't know about you. Anybody ever been on like a fishing boat or go out in the ocean a little bit? Yeah? All right. Look, I don't know what it is with salt air and boat and ocean, but I could have just eaten a half hour ago and all of a sudden I'm getting hungry. Yes? Right? I don't know what that is. Can you imagine 14 days not eating anything? So they were pretty scared. Yeah, that's what's going on here. So Paul says, verse 34, I pray you to take some meat, for this is for your health. And there shall not a hair fall from the head of any. Remember I told you, you're all going to make it. It's going to be okay. And they're like, you think so? You think? You sure? You think? Really? Verse 35. And when he had thus spoken, he took bread and gave thanks to God in the presence of them all. And when he had broken it, he began to eat. So they're like, guy's eating. Huh. And so, verse 36, then were they all of good cheer, and they also took some meat. Wow. And we were in all in the ship, Dr. Luke says, 216 souls, 276 lives that were being directly affected by God's servant, one man. See how God just kind of, little by little, elevates. Verse 38, and when they had eaten enough, they lightened the ship and cast out the wheat into the sea. What an exciting testimony here. And let's see if we can go on a little bit more. Verse 39, and when it was day, they knew not the land, but they discovered a certain creek with a shore into the which they were minded, if it were possible, to thrust into the ship. So they wanted to take the ship, let it blow into a part of the ground and kind of, you know, stop it. Okay? So verse 40, they took the anchors, they committed themselves unto the sea, and loosed the rudder bands, and hoisted up the main sail to the wind, and made toward shore. And falling into a place where the two seas met, they ran the ship aground, and the forepart stuck fast, and remained unmovable, but the hinder part was broken with the violence of the waves. Remember, God said, everybody's going to make it, but the ship isn't. So, here we go again. And the soldiers' counsel, verse 42, was to kill the prisoners, lest any of them should swim out and escape. But the centurion, willing to save who? Paul, kept them from their purpose, and commanded that they which could swim should cast themselves first into the sea and get to land. And the rest, some on boards, and some on broken pieces of the ship. And so it came to pass that they escaped. What's it say? All. Save. Just like God said. Wow. 276? 276. Okay. So, all of that to say that Paul was able to see God the whole storm through and have hope and peace and expectation from God, while the rest were what? So scared, they didn't eat for 14 days. Wow. So what are we getting? We're understanding that Paul said, whose I am, an angel appeared, a messenger, whose I am. And Paul was able to go through the same exact experiences, but come up with a completely different life experience. That's what we're called to do in the culture, in the life that we live here. Same basic experiences out here, but a different person on the inside because of the truth that you know and really believe. But it starts with not just having faith, but whose I am. I can't, what did he say? What did Watchman Nee say in his book? I must first have the sense of God's possession of me before I can have the sense of his presence with me. Turn that around in your mind a little bit more. When I know I'm God and God owns, I'm God's and God owns me, I can sense his presence differently. We need to get there. And we're going to have to get good at yielding ourselves more than once in a day to God's ownership of us, his rightful ownership of us, for our own good. Oh, but then I'd have to sacrifice and not do what I want to do. That's the plan. God's got a better plan. So sometimes I'll roll out of bed and, dear Lord, thank you for another day. Please help me to honestly yield my life to you anew and afresh. Please take control. And then I'm thinking, because you can do a much better job with it than I can, right? You can make me have a whole lot better day your way than my plan. There's safety in that. And I'm going to do it and I'm going to mean it if I really know God owns me. God owns me. Whose I am. The devil steals that from us and then we get fearful. We get focused on the whatever's going on around us, and we start to sink like Peter did, right? Remember that? Walking on the water, took his eyes off the Lord and looked at the storm and, Lord, save me! Right? Yeah. Bad things happen when we lose our focus on Jesus and his promises, don't they? Yeah, really bad. Unnecessary pain. We don't get credit for that. Oh, God, you saw the pain I was in. You did that to yourself. That's a lack of faith. Why? Wherefore did you doubt? How long must I suffer you? That's probably like, how long must I put up with you? It's like, come on, I got my limits. God is amazing, but the man side of Jesus, like, man, these people are slow. Yeah, they were a little dull, aren't we? Nice way of saying stupid spiritually. Anyway, myself included. Ask my wife, she'll tell you. Okay. I want to talk about here's the big thought. Can I say it this way? I must labor to understand and embrace the reality of God's ownership of me so I can sense his presence with me, enjoy his fellowship, glorify him no matter what is going on around me, life-threatening storms included. You see, sometimes we're too busy, so worried about the what-ifs, the what-ifs, the what-ifs, that we lose the what-is, the what-is, the what-is. And we lose our joy, and we don't have enough energy spiritually to see the people because we're too worried about, how am I going to make it? How can I get this peace? How? You say, if Paul, that guy, why do these guys have so much trouble if they're just trying to serve God and they had the harder life? Because it forced them to depend on God and not any circumstances, right? Why do churches that are being persecuted in China, in India, in Pakistan, in North Korea, go on and on, right? Why does God allow that? Because it purifies, it causes them to say, we got nothing going for us out there. We just have the promises of God and of Jesus. We need to understand, let those things that we don't like drive us to the point, yeah, there's no guarantees. My health is going to go. My health is going. My finances are iffy. It's okay. Don't get distracted. That's why it's easier for a rich man or a camel to go through an eye of a needle than for a rich man to go to heaven. What? It's the love of money, not money, the love of it. That's the root of every kind of evil. So we have a tendency to kind of shift our, you know, focus to, well, how much do I got in the bank? Or how healthy am I feeling? Or what did my doctor just say? That's going away, folks. I got news for you. First, the bad news. You're going down. All right? It's getting ugly, too. Yeah, the beauty, the fading, right? Eventually, it's all going to go away. But though the outward man is perishing, yet the inward man can be what? Renewed. What is it? Day by day. So take each day and zero in on it and say, all right, one by one, I can climb out of this hole that I'm in and just do the right thing, keep bringing myself back. God will help you, right? But it didn't matter. Paul said, I have what? Learned in whatever state I'm in. Therewith to be content. Oh, some people are just super spiritual. Wrong. My Bible says all have sinned. Right? My Bible says we're all as an unclean thing. Now, there's no naturally spiritual people. The spiritual people are the ones who spend time with God and His Word, and they meditate. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by what? The Word of God. Don't tell me I just don't have the faith. That's on you. It's on me if I go that route. God's given us the book. We got to get enough of it in us. And by the way, memorizing a little bit is a good thing. Find that one that speaks to you and just put it on an index card and carry it with you for a week. And then pretty soon after a week, once a week, then once a month, then go on to the next one. And you just go little by little. Pretty soon, you're just having that immediately available. So when Satan comes to try to distract you or to depress you or discourage you, you got something that you like that counteracts the error and the lie, right? The truth shall what? Make you free, right? So you're being lied to. God's not in control, or He doesn't care about you. God's in control, but you're on your own because you're just not that kind of close to God like other people are. See how He kind of lies? That's all He's got is lies and deceptions. So you have truth hidden in your heart that I might not sin against thee. You got to hide it. And by the way, it's worth it because then when the things come your way, you're boom, the Holy Spirit brings it right up into your mind and heart. And you nip it in the what, bud, early, right? Yeah, because a thought becomes what? An action. And an action, if it's wrong, becomes a habit, and a habit becomes what? Something entrenched in your character, and it starts to take control. But you can reverse the process in the positive as well. So Paul spent a lot of time with God, just like all great men and women of God. They spend time with God. You got to know what God's word is, and then you got to know whose you are. So just a couple other further facts. In Psalm 139, verse 13, if you ever need encouragement, I just need to be reminded about what God's really like, and is he really that powerful? Well, from my thoughts, I don't know how many hundreds of times, it's probably hundreds over my 40 plus years of being saved, that I've gone to Psalm 139 because it tells me everything I need to know about God that speaks to my heart. But verse 13, for thou hast possessed my reins, my inners. Thou hast covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well, or greatly. I'm wonderfully made. Guess what? If God made me, then God owns me. And God takes care of his stuff, his people. And so when God has possessed my reins, he's guided my development from the beginning. Even before the world began, we were in the mind and the heart of God. Wow. Except for Jim Kerr, the very hairs of your head are all numbered. He knows me and I know him for a long time. And he has some thick skin, so he can handle that. I could tell you some other things, but that's for another time. Lots of fun. All right, we move on and we say a couple other things. What's God's attitude? One of my other favorite verses, Jeremiah 29:11. Anybody know that one? For I know the thoughts. Say it with me if you know it. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you what? An expected end. I'm for you. I know what's going on and I got a plan. Just let me lead, please. Oh, give back control, please. You're out of control. When you're out of control, God's not in control. When you're in control, God's in control. Got to keep coming back to it, because we default away from God all the time, all the time, all the time. Keep correcting, keep correcting, keep correcting. Got to do it. Further facts of our ownership. For we are his workmanship, Ephesians 2:10, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Literally, when it says we are his workmanship, we are his masterpiece, is another way you could translate that. God is saying, you're made in my image and likeness, because you can pray and you can see and you can think about me and the things. You're special. You're at the height of my creator. That's why man was created last. That's why Satan hates mankind, because he hates God. And we're made in the image and likeness of God. So it's no wonder that he hates Jesus and he hates Jesus' followers. Right? But it's okay. Because if you resist the devil, he what? Will flee from you. Yeah. We are more than conquerors through him who loved us. That word, hupakaneo, means hyper-conquerors. We are super-conquerors through him. We just give it up. But we're not going to trust God the way we should unless, one, we really know he owns us. And then we can have, what, intimacy with God. And we can have power with God. So it always goes back. In Psalm 49a, I got to wrap this up. Pastor Steve gave me the two, but I'm not going there. Please don't come back for at least 8 years. Psalm 49a, for the Lord taketh pleasure in his people. I looked up what the term his people is. Literally means his tribe. But it's a little bit of a different idea. A tribe. Oh, they got some commonality. They got some cultural thing. They're distinct from other tribes. They're different from other peoples. For we are thy people. His people, his tribe. Think about that. God sees us differently when we're saved than we're in Christ. Wow. Out of all the 7.5 or whatever amount of billions of people, that small 2-3% that most mission agencies will tell you are, in their opinion, genuinely understanding and born again. Yeah, that's the tribe. You're part of the tribe. Owned by God. Whose I am. I'm in the tribe. I'm part of that tribe. Right? No wonder you had the 12 tribes of Judah. 12 tribes of Israel, right? Tribe. Yeah, good word. We move on. Psalm 85:6. Wilt thou not revive us again that thy people may rejoice in thee? Matthew Henry said this, His we are by creation, for he made us. By preservation, for he maintains us. By redemption, for he bought us. Good statement. That guy's a genius back in the 1600s, 1700s. That guy was at another level in so many ways. He uses words I don't never even heard of. Like, man, my education is worse than 1700, you know, guy lived during that time. Unbelievable. Jesus' view of us. Let's get our Bibles quickly to John chapter 13 and verse 13. We're still driving home the various points of Jesus owning us, right? So if you go to John 13 and verse 13, Jesus himself says this, You call me Master and Lord, and you say, Well, for so I am. So what do you get out of that? Well, the word curious means possessed. It means under authority. It means that there's a possessor and an owner and one having complete authority over. You call me Master and Lord, for so I am. I am your Master and I am your Lord. Like it or not, if you've trusted Jesus biblically and you were born again the Bible's way, then he is, whether you act like it or I act like it or feel like it, he is your Master and Lord. And that's a good thing. As he's saying, I own you. I own you. You're in my tribe. I was there when you were made, fearfully and wonderfully. You were not an afterthought. It was before the foundation of the world even began. I knew you. I had your hairs numbered, Jim. I had your hairs numbered, whoever else. Right? All of that. So, conclusion, we're owned and possessed by God. So let's not live in a fantasy world like we're not, because we are. And reject whatever seems to contradict that. You've got to be militant. Militant is good when it comes to biblical. You better be, or you're not going to do well spiritually. And you're going to live beneath your privilege. And it's not nice to live beneath your privilege. It isn't. Some people, I feel really... really bad for him, because I'm like, man, what a lousy life and even a worse future to come. And the afterlife, it just gets worse and worse and worse. But for we who are walking with God, it's getting better and better and better. Oh, you never have any problems then. Of course we got problems. Of course, you know, I'm not going to go into it, but hey, but in comparison to reality and where I'm going and what God says and the way things really are, it's okay. It's not a problem. I can do this. Because I reject whatever seems to contradict what God says. And I'm getting a nice place up in the heavens. I'm going to get a kingdom which cannot be ruled, or cannot, I can't lose. Wherefore, we receiving a kingdom which cannot be, what, lost? It can't be. A lot of things, people make promises all the time, right? Doesn't always work out, does it? If you buy this product, it's going to be the best. Horrible. Check the reviews. The reviews are wrong. Oh, well. Let me go on and finish up. Romans 8:15 to 17, Jesus said, "You have received the spirit of adoption." Wow. So we've been not only saved by God, given life by God, but then spiritually, we had to be what? Adopted by God. That word adoption means one placed as an adult son with all the rights and privileges. So if you lived with, in a house, and that person owning the house was a multimillionaire, but you were not yet adopted, you didn't have a whole lot to look forward to necessarily if nobody left a will behind. But once you got adopted, even though there are four other people, you're part of that adoption. And if it just says each child equally gets their 20% portion, as long as you've been adopted, you're right in there as a what? As a child. And God says, "I own you. I've numbered your hairs. I was there at the beginning. You're in my tribe." Right? And now I've adopted you. And then that term of endearment, whereby we cry what? Abba, Father. What is that? The Jew, when they prayed, "Oh, wonderful, majestic, holy God." Right? That's a Jew. Oh, you know, everything was, you know, covering all the ground. And "you who rule and reign, and Jacob's, you know, Abraham, you are the seed of, you have no beginning, no." And God, Jesus says now, whereby we cry, "Abba, Father." What? Call me in a reverent way, affectionately, Daddy. And you'll find some cultures, they refer to God in an affectionate, reverent way as Daddy. Not, he's my dad, the big dad upstairs. No! But he's not that all-powerful, distant, you know, God that is barely able to be ever approached. No. God's the best at everything. He's the full total of it all. And so, whereby we cry, Abba, Father, or Daddy. And of course, it goes on to talk about the Holy Spirit witnessing that we are His child. And we can go on beyond that. But in Ephesians 4:30, if that wasn't enough, the Bible also says, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption. So when you get saved, you get sealed. What do you know about seals? You didn't mess with the king's seal when he put that signet in the wax. You better not open that document, because why? It wasn't written to you, and if you mess with the king's seal, you're dying. You're gonna die. But it showed ownership, right? And so God says, we're sealed. He's put his ownership. Somebody said it this way, it's our first heavenly down payment. The Holy Spirit, if you got saved, His Spirit witnesses with your spirit that you are the child of God. There's a lot of things I can doubt at times in my life. But you know what? I honestly can't doubt that I am God's child. I honestly don't struggle whatsoever with, I wonder if I'm going to heaven. I wonder if Jesus really is my God, is my Savior. I'm not just saying it. It's the Holy Spirit's work, right, to show me that. That's how you know you're truly saved. You can honestly say, look, I'm not even trying to believe this. I know it. Are you there? If not, you need to straighten that process out. So God says His Spirit witnesses with our spirit. So we're sealed. And when God puts His seal on us, we're getting there. Now, how do we know we're sealed? The Holy Spirit is that seal. So it's like, I'm good for the rest. You're going to get a part of, you're going to get God and the person of the Holy Spirit as an assurance that the rest is coming just as I said. So if you know the Spirit dwells within you, the rest is coming. So as I close this out, whose are you? The real answer is going to determine what kind of life you live, what kind of joy you have, how you handle sufferings and difficulties. It's all about that. And we got to work hard to protect the essential truth that we are God's possession. We got to fight for it all the time. And when I do, then I know I'm going to be intimate with God because He owns me. He paid for me. He ever lives to make intercession. He says, you can come and call me Daddy in a reverent way. I'm sealed into the day of redemption. I'm part of His tribe. I wasn't an afterthought. I was there from the beginning in His mind. Wow. And I can serve a God like that. And that's what's going to make the difference for you and for your children and for your grandchildren and for other people around you, is that you have that confidence like the Apostle Paul. And God will show up in your life, but you've got to be putting it all out there. And then you'll see the presence of God no matter what's going on around you. And wouldn't that be nice? That it really doesn't matter. I've learned in whatever state I'm in there with to be content. I have all and I am full. He didn't just say, well, I'm surviving. How you doing? I'm surviving. No. Paul says, I'm thriving. I have all and am full. That's our privilege. That's our opportunity, but we got to cultivate that. Whose I am. Don't let the devil steal who you really belong to and revel in it. Let's pray. Father, we bow in the name of Jesus, so thankful that we can be reminded through your word over and over again that you are our God. You are our Father. You are our Daddy. And you have paid the most awesome, painful, valuable price to assure us that we're going to be okay with you now and in the future. So help us to not let Satan or our own lack of faith at times steal that truth. And then we have something to give to our children and our grandchildren, to our neighbors. The joy of the Lord, which is your strength. And so we praise you and thank you for making that legitimately possible for each of us. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I took my extra 15 minutes, but I hope it was worth it.
All right, let's take our hymnals. We'll open up to hymn 412. A Passion for Thee, hymn 412. When you get there, please stand.
Set my heart, O dear Father, on Thee and Thee only. Give me a thirst for Thy presence divine. Lord, keep my focus on loving Thee wholly. Purge me from earth, turn my heart after Thine. A passion for Thee, O Lord, set a fire in my soul, and a thirst for my God. Hear Thou my prayer, for Thy power impart, not just to serve, but to love Thee with all of my heart. Father, fill with Thy Spirit and fit me for service. Let love like Christ every motive inspire. Teach me to follow in selfless submission. Be Thou my joy and my soul's one for Thee, O Lord, set in my soul.
you're dismissed.